Oh, good morning. It is always an honor to be here. We've been having a conversation for the last week about how we can keep the change. It's February. Now, in January, maybe we all made some goals. We told some friends we'd do some things. And now we're kind of just checking in on you to see how things are going. And Jer made some amazing points last week. And just to recap, here was one of the things that he says. He says, one common denominator of people that have really changed is that they have a vision of where they're going. And the other thing that he said that I thought was extremely significant is that change is a process, it's not an event. And there are so many times where we put so much pressure on people to change right now. And in the Bible, we see so many examples of people that changed instantly, but we also see so many examples of people that God simply took on a journey. So if you're here today or if you're watching online and you're going, man, I get a little bit intimidated by all that happens in church. Can we just encourage you just to keep taking one step at a time? And today we're going to be looking at another common denominator of people that really have changed. And it's going to be found in the book of Mark. Mark chapter 4, verse 35, the Bible says this: on the same day when evening had come, he said to them, let us cross over to the other side. I want to speak to you on the subject today. Hello from the other side. Look at your neighbor on the right and say, hello from the other side. Look at your other neighbor and say, hello from the other side. Let's pray. Father, I ask that today you would show us how to get through some storms. You would show us how to indeed change. And Lord, may you show us how to keep that change. In the precious name of Jesus, everybody said. I don't know about you, but I grew up in a household where we always had to have something that rhymed for each year. So there was always like a slogan that went at the top of the year. In 2009, everything's going to be fine. In 2010, we're getting out of sin. In 2011, we're going to heaven. We still here. 2012, nobody's going to hell. Well, I don't know what happened that year. 2013, we're going to get clean. 2014, we're going to get lean. 2015, we're going to go green. 2016, we're living the dream. I think 2017, we should all eat some Krispy Kreme. I just think, you know, let's just gain 40 pounds, okay? How about some achievable goals, okay? Let's get some W's under our belt, you know, like something we can all do together. No matter who you are in the room, there's all of us that have some sort of lofty goals at the top of the year. One of the first things that we have is we have physical goals. Some of us signed up for gym memberships. Maybe those accounts have been frozen, whatever the case may be. You have a lot of healthy things that you want to accomplish. You're going to start adding kale to your diet, and this diet told you you were going to lose 20 pounds in 2 months. You lost 2 pounds in 2 months. You're like, forget this. I'm going to Portillo's, okay? And something just happens where, you know, by the time we reach now, it's just like, eh. It is what it is. Most diets give you a cheat meal. You took a cheat day that turned into a cheat week. Before you know it, you got a cheat life. And we're just kind of left with these just physical goals. And the next thing that we have are relational goals. Some of you have the goal of getting married this year. Come on. Some of you have the goal of staying married this year. Some of us just want to be a better parent. Better mom, better dad, better son, better daughter, co-worker, colleague, employee, employer. We have these goals, but somehow, you know, the line of what is most important and what gets our best attention and our priorities sometimes just get a little blurry. If you're a guy in the room, and if we could just be honest for a second, sometimes we live with the notion that it's only our job to put food on the table, that we don't have to be present when we get to the table. And I get it, because sometimes we make this goal like, okay, I'm going to spend more time with my kids, and I'm really going to be there. And I know what it's like, the difficulty, the tension that exists to be driven and present at the same time. And before you know it, by the time April comes and we're doing taxes, we will simply revert back to what we did before and just go, well, hey, I'm still doing my job according to society. And maybe our kids barely even see us. The other goals that we all have are financial goals. Unfortunately, you start saving and it's all great. It's all gravy. And you get an emergency fund. And then what happens? An emergency. And sometimes the emergency is greater than the emergency fund. And we find ourselves in the exact same boat that we were in before. Another thing we have is career goals. And some of us, all right, this is the year I'm going to start that business. This is the year I'm going to get that promotion. This is the year I'm going to make some moves. And we have a society that is addicted to constant progression. And some of us just feel like we're just not enough. And so we have these goals and we're like, okay, we're going to dream big at the beginning of the year. And then before you know it, you're using statements like, well, I got to do what I got to do. And all of a sudden your dreams get put on the shelf. And then we have why we're really here, spiritual goals. And some of you, you're like, all right, you know what? I'm going to read the whole Bible this year. Okay, that'd be good. I'm going to read it every day. I'm going to do devotionals, man. Like we're going to study the Bible. And almost like our diet, we give ourselves a cheat meal. You're like, if you ever read your Bible 6 days in a row and then you get to Sunday, you're like, well, I got to read my Bible today. Jared read the Bible for me today. You know, it's like you feel like I get a cheat meal. Before you know it, it's a cheat day. Before you know it, it's a cheat week. Before you know it, it's a cheat life. And God only hears from you whenever you have a problem. And then we find ourselves trying to keep these goals. And the interesting thing is I believe that a lot of us want to get to the other side. I think a lot of us want to get to the other side of our marriage problems, the other side of our financial struggles. And the thing that keeps us from getting to the other side is the same thing that kept the disciples from getting to their other side. Storms. Something happens. Storms. And I want to talk to you today if we could interview the disciples in Jesus about how they got to the other side. I want us to look at people that really have gotten to the other side of their struggles. And the verse continues like this. It says, on the same day when evening had come, he said to them, let us cross over to the other side. Now, when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was, and other little boats were also with him. The problem when we tell the story about Jesus calming the storm is that we envision it as a bunch of disciples in one singular boat. We picture Jesus on the water and it's just this one crazy storm. They're in this hurricane and they're just freaking out. And if you're honest, when you listen to your friends talk about their problems, don't they always talk about the problems like they're all alone? Like they're the only people in the world going through a divorce. They're the only people in the world with financial struggles. They're the only people in the world whose parents are, you fill in the blank, whose kids are fill in the blank. They're the only one, woe is me. And here's what I believe would happen if we could interview the disciples when they got across and maybe their hair is wet, their clothes are wet, and they're sopping wet, and they get to the other side. I think that they would say this, that they didn't have to go through the storm alone. Like, they at some point, they had to look around and go, wait, there's some other little boats with us. That we don't have to do life alone. And I believe that so many people have come into this place, maybe even watching online, and the biggest problem that you have right now is that you are facing your problems alone, that you are facing storms alone. And I think that each and every one of us should have three levels that I believe have a balanced relationship life. And we're going to talk about more relationships during the This Is Us series starting on March 12th. But I think the first thing that all of us should have is this, someone to look up to. Someone to look up to. And maybe that's a person that you know, and maybe that's a person that you don't know. but someone that you are watching that allows you to get through the storm. The second thing that I believe that we have to have is someone to show the way. Not just somebody that we're looking up to, but somebody that we are bringing along with us on the journey. And the third thing that I think that we all should have is someone to share the boat. Somebody that can sit with us and really, really know us. Someone that we can really, really do life with. I mean, ultimately, this is what I believe. I believe the bridge between information and transformation is inspiration. The reality is the only way you're really going to change is if something really, really bad happens and it forces you to change, or you're going to have to watch somebody. Information by itself isn't enough to change you. There are plenty of people that know Bible verses, but knowing what the Bible says without applying it doesn't matter. There are people that don't even believe in God that have the Bible memorized. But that's not an automatic change. In fact, the Bible says this in James 1, verse 22 to 25, but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourself, for if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in the mirror, for he looks at himself and goes away and at once forget what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being not a hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. I think every single person should have a front row seat to seeing somebody walk out the life of Christ. That's why life groups are important. That's why being in community is so important. I can't tell you how many people I've had a front row seat to see. It's one thing to say, hey, here's 19 things you need to know about money. That could give you the information, but unless you get around somebody that is good at handling money, it doesn't matter. Now, if you find yourself in a marriage situation, the way you are going to turn that around isn't just by thinking better thoughts. You've tried that before. You're going to have to get around another married couple that says, hey, this is how I came through the storm, and you don't have to go through yours alone. I'm a new parent trying to figure things out. Somebody told me we were about to hit the terrible twos. We've just been kind of naming and claiming it a little bit and calling it the terrific twos by faith. And it's been a fun journey because he's all boy. And a part of me feels like I know how to do a lot of things, but I've never been a parent before. I've been parented. But my father had me when he was 50. And so there were just different things. There was a gap for me of going, okay, I've got good information. I had a good dad, but I wasn't with my dad when I was two. Like watching it. Does that make sense? So I'm trying to figure out how in the world are we going to make decisions and how are we going to raise these kids? And the reality is there are people that do what I do for a living that have tried to raise their kids up in the things of God and have failed. And so I'm going, all right, train up a child in the way that he should go. I know the verse, but how do I connect the dots? And me and my wife, we started hanging around this couple in our church, and her kids are, I believe, 13 and 10. And they do this thing where they say, hey, we want to pray for other families. And I said, okay, so they come over to the house and they say, hey, we're gonna pray for you. And they say, well, hey, we do it a little bit different. So at one point we were trying to figure out how to do this parenting thing and we really didn't know. And so we were like, okay, are they gonna be lawyers? What college are they gonna go to? Are they gonna play sports? And so what we decided to do was to go, let's pull our minds away from that, but can we just simply train our kids to hear the voice of God? If we can train our kids to hear the voice of God, God will take care of them down the road. And she goes, so here's how prayer time works. What we do is we put 4 minutes on a clock and we just listen to God for you. They didn't say anything out loud. And these little kids began to just go, hey, here are some things that I feel like the Lord wants to say to you. And I'm like, how old are you? In just 4 minutes. And they're writing it down and say, hey, we want to gift this to you. And now in my house on a board says, can you give God 4 minutes today? Again, I know the verses. I can read books just fine. But something changes when you have a front row seat to seeing somebody do it, like live in front of you. And so we've got to do a better job of surrounding ourselves with the right people to go, hey, you know what, if I'm going to change, if I'm going to stop doing these things, well, I'm going to have to make some adjustments. And the bottom line is this, no one can keep the change alone. You cannot keep the change alone. And so many people feel like isolated. Well, I just need to get away from people because other people are stupid. Okay, like if I could just get away from all of these other opinions, then maybe I could really hear from God. And here's what I want to just teach you a little bit today. This is a Jewish term, havruta. And here's where its connotation comes from. Basically, the study of the Torah or study of the Old Testament, this is how they did it in the educational system. It was never done by themselves. It was always done with someone else to balance out their perspective. In fact, if you are just reading the Bible and you're reading the beginning of the New Testament books, the books are written to churches. Here's what would happen. Paul would write a letter and send it to the church. That church would not receive it and put it on a copy machine. Why? Because they didn't have one, okay? So it wasn't like they were passing out 1 Corinthians to everybody in the church, say, hey, each of you get one. Modern technology has allowed us to have multiple Bibles and multiple translations of it. But in its original text and original context, the letter would be read out loud and said, hey, how should we apply this together? Studying the Bible was a communal activity. The idea of a quiet time is very new. The idea of solo relationship with God is a very, very new idea for Christianity as a whole. If you study church history, they did it in community to say, hey, there might be something that you're seeing in my life and how I can apply this scripture that I can't see on my own. So would you help me? Could we havruta? Could we have fellowship together so that I don't miss the mark? And here's the next thing that I really want you to see. Other people can love you from the inside out, but they can see you from the outside in. Value their perspective. So when I'm trying to show you tough love, I'm going, hey, I know who you really are, and I love you anyways from the inside out. But I can see things that you cannot see. Right now, I cannot see myself. You can. So if I have something in my teeth, you're the only ones that could help me see that. Even if I turn around and look at the screen, I still will be looking at the back of my head. I desperately need other people's perspective, and sometimes, and can I tell you something, like how you handle correction will determine how far you go in life, how well you receive somebody telling you the truth, and how you respond in that scenario will determine if they ever tell you the truth again. Because if you get so angry and you just react, go, what are you talking about? You have just set up all of your family and friends to lie to you for the rest of your life. And they will massage your sin. They will massage your mistake. No, it's okay. Well, we can't tell him anything. You know people like that. You might be that person. How we receive correction and receive perspective. And here's the deal. I've just decided that I'm going to be a person that opens myself up to perspective so that person doesn't feel like they have to jam into my life. Like that they have to push through. Like the only way we can say something to Ryan is if he's in like a good mood and there's this recipe to talk to me. But can we just be people that just goes, hey man, could you give me perspective? Like when you come to my house, like what does it feel like? Hey man, like just give me perspective on my marriage. Like me and Amanda, like, I feel like we're doing great, but can you just,
And even for my wife to go, hey, you know, I felt like today went well, or I felt like this is going good, or I felt like this was our son. But what do you think? But sometimes we can just carry ourselves like we know it all when we may know nothing. Could we be people that just go, you know what? I value what other people have to say. And even if their perspective is wrong, it still gives me insight on something I could work on. And maybe it's something they could work on. And maybe they're trying to throw it on me. But nevertheless, I at least want to be open to somebody else's perspective and value that at a high level. Strong community multiplies our joys and divides our sorrows. I had a chance to go. I was speaking out in San Francisco, and it just so happened to be on the same day that the Cleveland Cavaliers were playing the Warriors. I don't know how that worked out, but Jesus is still Lord. Anyways, I ended up going to the game by myself, and I'm sitting there, and I'm just like, oh, man, I kind of wish I had spent the extra money to bring somebody, because I'm like, while I can be an introvert sometimes, sometimes I'm just like, man, this could be cool with somebody. And there was this guy, he had snuck down to the lower level, and he like became my buddy for about one quarter until the people showed up and took his seat, poor guy. And and so I'm sitting next to these two guys and this other couple from Australia. And she asked what wasn't the brightest question in the world, and I forgive her. She said, am I allowed to cheer for LeBron James tonight? And at the exact same time, like a choir, we went from being complete strangers to like a whole family. We all looked at her and went, no! And it was like, We're connected. We're exchanging phone numbers and sharing videos with each other from the game. It's like life is meant to be shared. I mean, I would just hate to just sit alone all the time and be laughing and not have somebody to just kind of like bump their elbow a little bit to share the laughter with. And I also would hate to sit in a hospital with a family member, and I'm be all alone, because then you can't divide the sorrow either. To say, hey, can I carry this with you a little bit? Can I sit with you a little bit? A girl in our church, she said to me the other day, she said, I've been coming to church for about 6 months. It's a big place, and I sit alone every single service. And I know of people that sit across the sanctuary, and I'm too embarrassed to ask them if I could sit with them. She said, thank you so much for life groups. It's going to change my life. Because it's going to give me the courage to sit with somebody and simply go, can I sit with you in church on Sunday? Life is meant to do it with other people. The other thing that I want us to look at is this, and I want us to ask ourselves this question. Who's helping you, near or far? Maybe it's a person you know. Maybe it's a person you don't know. Maybe it's a person you need to start podcasting. I have mentors that I know, and I have mentors I have never met in my life. But they are still playing a major role in my life. When I was growing up right here in Rockford, Illinois, there was a one of my best friend's parents. They wanted me to start studying the Bible a little bit more. And so they said, hey, for every message you listen to and write a report on, I'll give you $5. I said, you about to go broke. You done told the wrong person. I'm like, I'm about to get allowance from y'all on a weekly basis. Like, I'm going to do 20 messages. That's not a problem. I'm a PK. Like, what? Are you serious? And I got to Facebook him the other day and just say, hey, I know you don't keep up with what I do for a living, but you helped me. You did something for me. The other question isn't just who's helping you, but who are you helping? I think a lot of times we can fall for the trap of, when is somebody going to help me? Here's the reality. You can't always control who's going to help you, but you can control who you help. There's somebody in your world today that you can help. There's definitely somebody at your job tomorrow morning that you can help. There's somebody at your school that you can help. And so is there somebody in your world that you can go, all right, you know what? I'm going to be a person that decides to sow seeds into other people. I love this verse. What began to happen with the church at Corinth is they decided to say, well, I like Apollos versus Paul. And they were kind of going back and forth. And Paul says this, for when one says, I follow Paul, and another says, I follow Apollos, are you not mere human beings? What, after all, is Apollos? And what is Paul? Only servants through whom you came to believe as the Lord has assigned to each his task. I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God has been making it grow. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything but only God who makes things grow. That's how I see my life. I'm either planting the seed or I'm watering it. And that's just how I live my life. I just go, hey, here's the deal. Now, maybe somebody told you that you could achieve your dreams a long time ago. That was seed. Right now, I'm just trying to throw some water on it to go, yeah, you can. They were right. When I was in middle school here, I had an opportunity to make a decision about my life, the direction of my life. There was a guy named Tim Brown. I don't know if he's even here in the service, but he's one of the greatest basketball players in Christian life history. And he played AAU ball, and he was kind of showing me the path to get a D1 scholarship, and he got one. And you had to get on the AAU team, but you had to get invited. And so I, long story short, played in a 3-on-3 tournament at Rock Valley College and did really well one day. And an AAU coach said, hey, I want you on my team. And I went, I've made it. And around the same time, we were starting this thing here at the church called Next Generation. And we were doing a mission trip to Atlanta, and I couldn't do both. And I had to make a decision early that I knew in eighth grade I wasn't going to go D1. Because I knew what I really wanted to do with my life. And I knew that even if I got to the NBA, I'd be really short there. And two, how long can you really play? The number one question of NFL and NBA players is, what am I going to do when I can't play anymore? And I just figured, man, do I really want to go through that? And decided to go through Next Generation. And we had this really cool guy, skinny youth pastor. His name's Jeremy DeWert. And we were down in the basement of Christian Life High School, and he started preaching on Ephesians, and he starts breaking down the city of Ephesus and their economic status. And I remember to this day, I was like a kid in a candy store. I was just leaning over just like, how in the world is he doing that? Like, this dude is amazing, and I want to do that. How I feel right now, I want to make other people feel when I talk. And I walked up to him and I was like, hey, how did you do that? How did you know all of that info? And in like classic Jeremy DeWert fashion, he just goes, here's my notes. Here's my notes. Here you go. And what did he do in that moment? Planted a seed. I mean, it's not like in that moment he could, because I was shorter than him at the time, so he would have had to do this. It's not like he said, hey, kid, one day, you and me are going to be teammates. Hey, well, one day, we're going to be, like, helping lead this place called City First Church. And so today, I'm going to give you my notes and hope that this moment turns into something. We can't see that far. We're not God. But can we just act like destiny is on the line when we sow seed? Can we just do it anyways? Can we just go, hey, you know what? There's somebody in my world, and I don't know who they're going to become, and I don't care. It's just my job to sow the seed. It's God's job to make it grow. And maybe somewhere along the line, somebody has watered it here and there. I think this is how we get through storms. I think this is how we really keep the changes, because on some level, when you know that somebody's counting on you, it gives you a little bit of extra motivation to go, man, I can't let him down. And when we've got somebody that has been teaching us something, we go, man, I don't want their labor to be in vain. So, like, can we be people that begin to look around at our community and begin to make some adjustments to go, okay, who's in my boat? Who am I helping? Who's helping me? Who am I showing the way and who's helping me along the road? We already know how the story ends, but I want us to highlight something about Jesus' stature during the story. But he was in the stern asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" Then he arose, rebuked the wind, and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. But he said to them, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith?" And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, "Who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey him?" I don't know what all your goals are for this year, but I pray that you, as you begin to look around at who's in your boat, and you begin to make some decisions and adjustments on that to keep the change and get through the storm, can we just remember that Jesus is in the boat too? I mean, can we just, can we just have enough pause moments this year to go, Jesus, don't let me miss the fact that you are in the midst of the storm with me. And that we, just like them, can feel at times like, do you care? Are you with, I don't feel like I can feel you in the storm. In fact, it kind of feels like you're sleeping. Maybe we could take a lesson from Jesus and calm ourselves down too. Maybe for us, we could take a note from his posture and go, am I afraid that God is going to let me down? If I'm Jesus, I would have got up from my nap and I would have said, so let me get this straight, everybody. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but Jesus and his friends are going to die on the sea on a boat. You think I came to the planet to let you die? Last thing I want you to know is this, is Jesus didn't die for you to leave you. He didn't go through all of that work to just go, well, good luck. He's with you in the midst of everything that you're going through, and above even your community, above even the storm that we could get our eyes fixed on. Do we have a moment where we just kind of sit in the boat and just go, wait a minute, who's on my team? Jesus. And if Jesus is with me, I'm good. I don't want to keep my eyes on the storm. I want to keep my eyes on the one who controls the weather of my life. God, I thank you so much for City First Church. I pray, Lord, that you would be the thing that helps us keep the change. And we've got a lot of things that we'd like to see accomplished this year. And I pray, God, that you would enable us to do that. And Lord, that as we begin to evaluate the community around us, I pray that that there would be divine appointments, that you would help people push past their barriers and step into life groups, and maybe they go to a Next Steps booth, and maybe that's a brave step for them, to maybe to be able to have somebody to sit with them in a service. I pray, Lord, that no one in this room would walk their journey with you alone. In the precious name of Jesus, everybody said, amen. Hey, why don't you go ahead and stand on your feet? If it is your first time, or if you'd like to take your next step in your journey with Christ, there is a Next Steps booth. We have some amazing volunteers that would love to answer any of your questions. Also, if you have anything that we could pray for, our prayer teams are down here at the front. We would love to pray with you. We will see you next week. Everybody have a great week.